So let's figure out how to do a paired samples t-test in JASP. We will be using the PuppyTrainingPaired.csv dataset, which is the same data that we used for the independent samples t-test. In fact, if you have not already seen it, I would encourage you to watch the independent samples t-test video first, before this one, because these two approaches to the t-test are designed to be taught side by side. So here is the setup for our research. There are two popular ways to train dogs. One involves using a clicker, which creates a sharp click that reinforces when the dog has done something right. The other method, of course, is food training, or treats, in which the dog gets a small morsel when he responds correctly. Because this is a paired samples t-test, the researcher is going to use matched pairs of dogs in each group. Mickey is a dog trainer studying reinforcement effectiveness. He gets 16 puppies from 8 litters, with 2 puppies from each litter. He matches each puppy in clicker training with its litter mate in food reward training. After training the puppies, he measures the number of correct responses by each puppy in 10 exercises. Was there a difference between the two training techniques? Let's walk through the 5 steps of hypothesis testing. Step 1, select the appropriate statistic. We will compare 2 dependent samples. One sample is the puppies who were trained using clicker training. And the second sample was their litter mates, the twin siblings, if you will, who were trained with food reward. Because they are matched pairs, their scores are not independent. To compare these two samples, we will use a paired samples t-test. Step 2, state the null and alternative hypothesis. We want to know if the means of the two samples of puppies are different. We are not saying which group will be better, so this is a two-tailed test. If we said that one group was better, this would be a one-tailed or directional test. Because this is a two-tailed test, our null hypothesis will be either H0: mu1 equals mu2, or mu d equals 0. The mean difference equals 0. That means that our alternative hypothesis will be H1: mu1 does not equal mu2, or mu d does not equal 0. Step 3, select a level of significance. We have already established that this is a two-tailed test. Our alpha level is going to be 0.05. The degrees of freedom for the paired samples t-test is n minus 1, where n equals number of pairs of samples. We have 8 pairs of puppies divided into the two groups, so n minus 1 equals 7. From students' t-table, the critical value for a two-tailed test, alpha 0.05, degrees of freedom equals 7, is positive or negative 2.365. So any t-values exceeding 2.365 indicate that the sample of puppies being trained with clicker training was statistically significantly different than the puppies being trained with food reward training. Step 4. Calculate the statistics. So now we need to turn to JASP. Begin by placing the puppy training data on your computer desktop. We will open our dataset by going to our main menu icon, Open, Computer, Desktop, PuppyTrainingPaired.csv, and then clicking Open. Let's begin by looking at our data. The first of the two variables that we will use is clicker, which is the number of tasks correct out of 10 for the puppies trained with clickers. The second variable is food, which is the number of tasks correct out of 10 for the puppies trained with food rewards. Both of these are scale variables, but they were imported as ordinal. On the left edge of each box, we can click here to change column type and set it to scale. Do not click on the variable name or you will be changing variable labels. Click on the left edge of the box. And now we are ready to do the analysis. Currently, I have 6 basic analysis options available. I could add more modules with the plus sign, but I don't need to do that now. Basic modules are exactly what I need. Select t-tests, paired samples t-test. We need to place the variables according to their pairs. If this was a before and after design, we would enter the before first and then the after score. In our matched pair design, we will move the clicker group into the variables pairs box first, and then their paired food groups scores second. If we had a larger data set with more variables, we could add more pairs. Reversing the order of the pairs gives us exactly the same output, so we will not need to do that. In the results window, we see the paired samples t-test statistics. We can already see that the p is less than 0.05, so this test is statistically significant. This is a good start. But I want to know much more. All I need to do is select the options that I prefer. We have an option for the non-parametric alternative test, Wilcoxon signed rank test, but we will not need to do that now. Notice that we do not have a Welch's t-test option because, again, we do not have to account for pre-existing variance. Because we are testing paired groups, or sometimes the same group, any variability between the groups is coming from the main effects and not pre-existing variability. Therefore, we do not need to check for homogeneity of variance with a Levine's test like we did with an independent samples t-test. This is not an issue with this research design. There is no homogeneity of variance among the assumptions tests, but we will check for the assumption of normality. Here we notice that we may have a problem. The assumptions check says that these results suggest a deviation from normality. The probability is less than 0.05. What should we do? Well, we have the option of transforming the dataset by squaring the values or by using an inverse, but these transformations can make interpreting the findings much more difficult. So first, we need to consider how badly violated the assumptions can be before we start to worry. While we tend to interpret t-tests and other hypothesis tests at the p equals 0.05 level, for assumptions tests, we usually use the p equals 0.01 level. And with larger datasets, it is very common not to transform data or drop outliers unless they exceed p less than 0.001. So we are not going to worry about this p.03 deviation. Our results will still be valid. You recall from step 2 that our alternative hypothesis is that the means of the two groups are not equal. We could also choose one-tailed test options here if we wanted to. Under additional statistics, I am going to get a location parameter with 95% confidence intervals. I want a Cohen's d effect size, descriptive statistics, and a descriptives plot. In the output window, we see the group statistics. I want to begin by scrolling to the bottom. I always like to see a picture of the data before I begin interpreting. I see that the food reward group mean was lower than the clicker training group. There is a fair amount of overlap in those error bars, but not as much as when we examined the plot for the independent samples t-test. The top of this food group error bar is still lower than the mean of the clicker group. I would probably not include this plot in my write-up or in my paper, but it is a good place to begin. I can also see the descriptive statistics for each group. The food group was more than a full point lower than clicker training. These will be important to report later. With these thoughts in mind, let's scroll back to the top. We see the t-test results, the probability, and the mean difference. If you subtract the food mean from the clicker mean, the difference between those two means would be 1.25. We have our confidence intervals, and out here to the right, we see the effect size. The Cohen's d is a 0.975. We'll round that up to a 0.98. This is a much larger effect size than the 0.80 we found with the independent samples t-test. One reason that this Cohen's d is larger is because these two variables, clicker and food, are correlated, and that intercorrelation between the variables is inflating the Cohen's d. There is a way to correct for this using a formula, but I will cover that in another video. So how can we interpret these findings? First, the t-test value is 2.758, which exceeds the critical value of positive or negative 2.365. Degrees of freedom is 7. We can see that the significance value for our t-test is 0.028, which is less than 0.05. And we also see that the 95% confidence interval for mean differences between paired sample means shows a lower bound of positive 0.178 and an upper bound of positive 2.322. Because this confidence interval does not cross zero, it does not include the null hypothesis value of zero difference. So the groups are different. All three of these findings tell us the same thing. There is a statistically significant difference between these two means. In addition, we see Cohen's d is a 0.98, which is a very large effect. Let's go back to our five steps of hypothesis testing. Step 4, calculate the statistics. The t-test value is a 2.758, which we will round to a 2.76. The p-value is a 0.028. Using the analogy of a dollar, this p-value is 2.8 cents, which is less than a nickel, or 0.05. That means that the t-test is significant and the two groups are statistically significantly different. Finally, step 5, make the decision. Clicker training was more effective than traditional food reward training. Notice that I list the means and standard deviations for each group and the full write-up for the t-test. Here is an example of how we might write up these results in APA style. First, I would describe my research design and how I conducted the experiment. Then I would describe my assumptions checks. We will interpret the Shapiro Wilk test at the 0.01 level, which is common for assumptions checks, and we will not transform these data to correct for that non-normality. They do not deviate from normality badly enough to warrant that. Then I would report the findings from my t-test, including the confidence interval and the effect size. I would also include the means and standard deviations for each group. And those come from the descriptive statistics. Notice the conclusion. These findings support the idea that clicker training is more effective than traditional food reward training. This last statement about the meaning of the findings would go in your discussion section if you were writing this up for an academic paper. And finally, look at the data for these two tests. You will notice something remarkable. The data are exactly the same. The group means are exactly the same in both tests. And yet, the independent samples t-test was not significant, but the paired samples t-test with exactly the same numbers was significant. This illustrates that a paired samples t-test, and repeated measures in general, is more powerful than an independent samples t-test. That means that we are more likely to find a statistically significant difference between the groups. That does not mean that there's anything wrong with using an independent samples t-test, only that you should consider the power of your test when you do your research design.